Morning. Shalom, everyone. I'm Brother Doug with my mom's sister Sharon right next to me over here. And we got Brother Yehusha, Sister Marissa. And we are going to be doing our normal Shabbat day readings that we usually do. So let's see here. We're at just because I got to get my that's a good one. Just because you're already ready, Mom, you already got your scriptures open. Could you read chapter 1 Kings 21? We're going to start at 1 Kings
Sure.
21 here. That will give me a chance to get the scriptures on the screen here. Whenever you're ready, Ma.
Okay. Sometime later, there was an incident involving a vineyard belonging to Lot, the Jezreelite. The vineyard was in Jezreel, close to the palace of Ahab, king of Samaria. Ahab said to Naboth, "Let me have your vineyard to use for a vegetable garden, since it is close to my palace. In exchange, I will give you a better vineyard, or if you prefer, I will pay you whatever it is worth." But Naboth replied, "Yahuwah forbid that I should give you the inheritance of my fathers." So Ahab went home sullen and angry because Naboth the Jezreelite had said, "I will not give you the inheritance of my fathers." He lay on his bed, sulking and refused to eat. His wife, Jezebel, came in and asked him, "Why are you so sullen? Why won't you eat?" He answered her, "Because I said to Naboth the Jezreelite, 'Sell me your vineyard, or if you prefer, I will give you another vineyard in its place.' But he said, 'I will not give you my vineyard.' Jezebel, his wife, said, 'Is this how you act as king over Yashrael? Get up and eat. Cheer up. I'll get you the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite.' So she wrote letters in Ahab's name, placed his seal on them, and sent them to the elders and nobles who lived in Naboth's city with him. In those letters, she wrote, 'Proclaim a day of fasting and seat Naboth in a prominent place among the people, but seat two scoundrels opposite him and have them testify that he has cursed both Elua and the king. Then take him out and stone him to death.' So the elders and nobles who lived in Naboth's city did as Jezebel directed in the letter she had written to them. They proclaimed a fast and seated Naboth in a prominent place among the people. Then two scoundrels came and sat opposite him and brought charges against Naboth before the people, saying, 'Naboth has cursed both Elua and the king.' So they took him outside the city and stoned him to death. Then they sent word to Jezebel, 'Naboth has been stoned to death and is dead.' As soon as Jezebel heard that Naboth had been stoned to death, she said to Ahab, 'Get up and take possession of the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite that he refused to sell you. He is no longer alive, but dead.' When Ahab heard that Naboth was dead, he got up and went down to take possession of Naboth's vineyard. Then the word of Yahuwah came to Elijah the Tishbite, 'Go down to meet Ahab, king of Yashrael, who rules in Samaria. He is now in Naboth's vineyard, where he has gone to take possession of it. Say to him, this is what Yahuwah says: Have you not murdered a man and seized his property? Then say to him, this is what Yahuwah says: In the place where dogs licked up Naboth's blood, dogs will lick up your blood. Yes, yours.' Ahab said to Elijah, 'So you have found me, my enemy.' 'I have found you,' he answered, 'because you have sold yourself to do evil in the eyes of Yahuwah. I am going to bring disaster on you. I will consume your descendants and cut off from Ahab every last male in Yashrael, slave or free. I will make your house like that of Jeroboam, son of Nebat, and that of Baasha, son of Ahiah, because you have provoked me to anger and have caused Yashrael to sin. And also concerning Jezebel, Yahuwah says, dogs will devour Jezebel by the wall of Jezreel. Dogs will eat those belongings to Ahab who die in the city, and the birds of the air will feed on those who die in the country. There was never a man like Ahab who sold himself to do evil in the eyes of Yahuwah, urged on by Jezebel, his wife. He behaved in the vilest manner by going after idols like the Amorites that Yahuwah, drove out before Yashrael. When Ahab heard these words, he tore his clothes, put on sackcloth, and fasted. He lay in sackcloth and went around meekly. Then the word of Yahuwah came to Elijah the Tishbite. Have you noticed how Ahab has humbled himself before me? Because he has humbled himself, I will not bring disaster in his day, but I will bring it on his house in the days of his son.
It's interesting. You have two different instances. One where it seems like he's not really genuine. Let me see. It says in verse 16, and it came to pass when Ahab heard that Naboth the Jezreelite was dead, that he tore his clothes and put on sackcloth. And it came to pass afterward that Ahab rose and went down to the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite to take possession of it. So this putting on sackcloth in mourning seems to be more just that's tradition, you know, like that's what we do to guys, versus later on when he rebuked and told all these things that's going to befall him, then he truly puts on sackcloth and repents. Right.
Yeah.
But not until he's faced with the repercussions. But even in that, like, it's interesting that Yahuwah still accepted it.
Yes, I thought so too. I thought so too. Yeah. Yeah. It's pretty matter of fact, you know, this the events that happened.
I think with these men, elders that the letter was sent to, because it says set two men, sons of transgressors, before him and let them testify against him, saying he blasphemed. I mean, like, if I was in their place, I would like to think, that's a really strange request. Like, why am I doing this? Especially if I'm an elder over them. Like, so either these men are just really naive elders, or they're elders to go along with it.
Yeah. I was also thinking, you know, what a beta male king he must have been to have, you know, him to be like basically pouting and you know, his evil wife to have to come around and like basically take care of business. You know, she's the one that actually, you know, as evil and wicked, of course, that it was, but she was the one that was making plans and doing things, and there he is sulking.
Yeah.
You know, and he's supposed to be the king.
It's more like she's the king and he's the queen. Right. He's just enjoying the high life while she takes care of everything.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah.
Yep.
I'm gonna look up sullen. What does sullen really mean?
First like says sullen in yours.
Said when she comes at him and says, "Why are you?" His wife Jezebel came in and asked, "Okay, this is verse 5. Why are you so sullen? Why won't you eat?"
Like, basically, why are you pouting?
Yeah.
It's weird. Your verse 5 is a lot different than mine. Are you sure you're in 1 Kings 21?
Yes.
That's strange. Oh! Hold on. I keep forgetting. Hold on. Yeah, I wonder if they fixed the orderings of this correctly or not. Yeah, because mine says a lot different. The messengers came again and said, "Thus says the son of Adar, I sent to you saying, you shall give me your silver and gold and your children." That's a lot different.
But why does it say very top of their Naboth vineyard and then has nothing to do with Naboth's vineyard?
Yeah, I think there's chapter numbering issues with Breton's. Let me see here.
I think in the box.
Yeah. Let me go to my sword and see if they probably never fixed the chapter numberings issue and the fact that First Kings to them is like Third Kings. They probably never corrected that. Yeah, see, even when you correct the, even when you link it up, 1 Kings to 3 Kings, the chapter numberings are still off a bit. The original Bretons would have had this chapter as chapter 20. See, that's the good thing about the My Sword. They at least give you that in the parentheses. See this month? See this blue here?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's showing you, see the original number?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
20 verse 1 versus 21 verse 1. It's a whole chapter off.
Oh, well, I read 21.
No, what I'm trying to say is for us that are using the Septuagint,
oh, I got
we you. Need to yeah. have a guide to know.
Yeah, it gets confusing. Yeah.
Okay, so chapter 20 is originally what it was, verse 5. Jezebel, his wife, went to him, yeah. Yeah, see, the Septuagint makes more sense than Sully. I don't know. That's got to be a British thing.
Oh, yeah, I believe so.
Why does the NIV use Old English, like Middle English? Like
I don't
that?
Know. They do sometimes.
That's weird. Mm-hmm. I don't see the point of that. It's supposed to be contemporary English. I don't see the point of that.
They're probably trying to stay in, whatever with King James.
Because for Bretons to say spirit troubled, Breton was made in the 1800s, so why are they? To me, that's just unless they updated the Bretons to be more modern English. Mm-hmm. That's weird that an 1800s translation would be more clear than
You also take into consideration that you can't have another translation that is the same without changing something. You know, you have to at least
true.
it's just weird because I've seen, if I was to look at the like for example, let me look at the NLT here, which is a very modern.
And I think that sullen, whether you say sullen, pouting, depressed, spirit troubled, they would all technically be the same thing. Spirit, because you can't see having a troubled spirit. It's manifested in their actions and what they're doing.
Right.
Yeah, I just wanted to see, because most of us would not know what the heck sullen means. Like, that's a very old word. That's,
well, Webster said gloomy, pouty, you know, all the things we've been saying. So yeah, it basically covers the whole thing.
Just weird that it would. Yeah, because usually contemporary versions don't go with the Middle English like that. That's very strange. Places you think the NIV would be clearer, sometimes it's not. That's.
I don't know. I would see sullen used before, like when I was growing up reading books and like more modern day books. So it's still modern.
I just never seen the word before in my life, other than.
I've heard it, but I just wasn't that sure what exactly, you know, it meant. So it basically meant all the things we were saying.
It's usually the modern versions, like the NLT will say, "Why is your spirit upset?" Usually it's more modern, like they don't
depressed,
usually
upset,
use those type of words.
Multi.
Yeah. So other than that,
he must have been kind of pathetic, I'm thinking. I mean,
he's the example of what, like, forgive me for using modern terminology today, what a simp is. He's the perfect example, Ahab. He let his woman walk all over him.
Yeah.
He doesn't stand for Yahuwah. He lets a woman control him. He's a perfect example. He's like the situation of Adam and Kua times like 1,000.
Yeah.
And it's like 10 times worse than what Adam was supposed to do and didn't do. And
right.
And Ahab is letting his woman actually control their relationship and who they serve. That was Ahab's biggest problem, was he probably didn't want to be a Baal worshiper, but because he had no backbone, he made the same mistake Solomon did. Solomon, you know, his weakness was women.
Yeah.
And, you know, given Solomon, you know, didn't get corrupted until he had too many wives, but Ahab still has the same problem. And, you know, I mean, he's a perfect example of what people call today beta males, simps, men that can't stand up.
No backbone.
They're a doormat to women. That's a perfect example.
The feminists must love her.
Oh yeah,
she must be like a poster child.
Lilith is actually probably their poster child, if I remember correctly.
Okay.
Their Lilith would be like who they like idolize. You know, because supposedly the legend goes that she like did not want to be subordinate to Adam, and that's why she was kicked out. So that whole Kabbalistic legend, the feminists love that. They love stuff like that. But it's a fake legend, but
yeah,
the world would want to idolize something like that. it's gear.
The regarding these elders that go along with the plan. You think that they're just naive and they have no idea, or do you think that they're wicked?
They're probably knowing what's going on And they probably are too afraid to do something to Jezebel. I think that's what's going on. Isabel, I should say. Jezebel is like a mistranslation. It's supposed to be Isabel. But, yeah, I think they're just afraid. They're not standing up either to her. And that seems to be Israel's problem, is that whenever stuff like this would happen, you know, you would have the men just falling in line and not doing what they're supposed to be doing. Yeah. I think also, didn't Ahab have like pagan priests too?
I'm not sure.
He allowed to have like these priests of the high places and this and that.
Had the priests of Baal, and Isabel had the priests of Ashtaroth.
Yeah, so you had these priests probably, you know, in control, had more say so than these elders. If they're not standing up to her, what's ironic is she gets fed to the dogs. And in a spiritual sense, that's ironic. Because Kepha says, like a sinner that goes back to their sin is like a dog that goes back to its vomit.
Yeah.
So for her to get eaten up by dogs.
Yeah.
Yeah. And dogs actually supposed to represent the Gentiles. In a spiritual way, like that one woman that talks about, don't they feed the dog what's at the master's table and all that, because Yahushua called her a dog. So the Samaritans, I think there's like a background to that too. Kind of ironic, he feeds her to physical dogs because the Samaritans were looked at as dogs. And if you look at who Ahab was the king of, he was the king of the northern house, not the southern house. It's kind of ironic. And now what's interesting is this mentions here in the very last, one of the last verses, talks about the Amorites out of nowhere. Oh, okay, I see why. He did very abominably, falling after the abominations according to all the Amorites did, whom Yahuwah utterly destroyed. Now, this is what I was talking about earlier. Remember off the record, I mentioned earlier today that one of the tribes we know for a fact are destroyed, the Amorites are. So their bloodline would be done.
Did you say?
Yeah, like, you know, to the throat, done. Like they're exterminated, according to verse 26 there. Yahuwah utterly destroyed before the children of Yashrael. So it seems like the Amorites are done. I think the reason Amos 2 mentions them, it's like a what do they call it? Not a foreshadowing, but a backdrop to something that happened like way before. Because according to this, in the time of 1 Kings, they're already dead. There's none left. I think Og was the last. He was the last one of the Amorites. And let me see here. Ahab, because of the word of Ahab. Now, this is interesting. Oh, go ahead.
Could it also mean that they were just simply wiped out as a people, not necessarily like as a nation? Because like we see places in Joshua where it says that, you know, he completely, that they went in, they completely wiped out, and yet they didn't completely wipe out, you know. It says that they went in and entered into, I don't know, there's places in Joshua where it says things, but then it's not complete, right? I'd have to find some examples. Let me see if I... Instead of just talking out the side of my
I think Sihon was one of the last that's mentioned in their conquests in Deuteronomy, from what I remember, they did utterly wipe them out, like, ethnically. I don't think there was any that were left over. They were like one of the few tribes they actually did what Yahuwah actually told them to do regarding them. Where I think they screwed up was the Canaanites. Mm-hmm. The Hittites were not utterly destroyed.
Right.
The Girgashites were not utterly destroyed. The Jebusites weren't, I don't think, because you still had Jebusites in the land when they took over Jerusalem. I think the Amorites were wiped out, though, if I remember correct. I know Sihon was their last king. I'm trying to find online here any resources. I would say he's the last. Let me see. Did Israel utterly wipe out the Amorites? Wipe out the Amorites. Let's see here. Yeah, I'm not getting much answers here.
Okay, here's an example of one of the things that I was referring to. Joshua 11, 22 to 23. It says one thing, but it's not completely accurate in what it says. So it says, there was none left of the Anakim of the children of Yashur all. Only there was left of them in Gaza and in Gath and in Ashdod. And Yahusha took all the land as Yahuwah commanded Moshe. Mm-hmm. And Yahusha gave an inheritance to Yashrael by division, and the land ceased from war. Only all the land wasn't taken. We know that because, like, as you continue in Yahusha, there's a lot of land that hasn't been taken. There's a lot of people that haven't been conquered.
That's why we get the book of Judges, and all the trouble in there was because they didn't wipe these people out completely.
That's so true.
Like, I wonder if when it says that the Amorites were completely wiped out, if it literally means like every single living Amorite was destroyed, or if it meant like as a nation, like they no longer exist, except for like people, nations.
Possible.
It is possible.
I want to look at also Amos 2:9 and what the context of that is, because that's the only verse I could really think of that would support that they would still be around, you know, going into the prophet's time period.
Right.
Let me just see here. I want to look at the context of Amos 2. Let me see here. So, because it's very general here. Let me see here. It says three sins of Moab, judging Moab, drunk wine. Okay. So a lot of that is like end times prophecy type of stuff. Okay. Nevertheless, I cut off the Amorite from before them, whose height was as the height of a cedar. He was as strong as an oak. I dried up his fruit from above, his roots from beneath. Okay, that's not really being specific enough. I mean, the only one that actually says that verbatimly that they're utterly destroyed is Joshua 24:8. Which again, it could be interpreted that that means as a nation. Mm-hmm. I always interpreted that they're just no more, like they're ethnically, they're not a people anymore, because
right.
I don't see the Amorites after that. Like, they're non-existent. Unless I'm wrong and they're somewhere in history, they still would have existed. It seems like they disappeared after the book of Yahusha.
Mm-hmm. I think I would actually side with them being completely wiped out, like in the literal sense. like just considering that now, the command that was given, you know, you go, you wipe out every woman and child. And, you're probably right.
The hit, I know there's other tribes that on this point haven't been
right.
Many of them weren't. I think their Amorites were one of the few that scripture says they were. Would be the Amorites, and maybe I would have to look back at the Canaanites possibly. I don't know. There might actually be a remnant of Canaanites still, even in the New Testament time period, unless there's mistranslation there. There mentions like a Canaanite who joined Yahusha's ministry, which is really interesting. So, supposedly. So, yeah, I would have to look into the Canaanite thing. The Hivites, I'm not too sure whether they were exterminated or not. Mm. They might have not been. The Hivites, the Jebusites, the Hittites, many of them were not utterly wiped out. Because you see in King Solomon's time period, they're all, and that would actually be a good verse. Now we're on this topic. That would be a good verse to actually look at to prove our point here is to go to King Solomon. Let me see here. Let me actually, I would rather use Firefox.
Wow, you have a lot of apps, man.
Yeah, some of them are job apps like Glassdoor and all of them. Some of them are survey apps like Pogo and all that.
I found a verse in Judges where it says here. The Israelites lived among the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites.
Yeah, I got to get rid of that Telegram X, actually.
What did you say? What verse was that?
That's Judges chapter 3, verse 5. It just lists all of them that Israel was living amongst.
I'm trying to look at Solomon's compulsory labor is the one I'm thinking of. It's in 1 Kings, I believe, where it talks about... I just swore I had... I guess that's the only browser I have on there. Hold on a second.
My mom just brought up actually might show that that all the Amorites might not have been wiped out in Joshua, because this is Judges 3, where it says they were to prove Joshua by them, and the Amorites are listed.
Interesting. So I guess maybe we're wrong. Maybe there was a remnant of them still left. I know around Solomon's time, though, it seems like they were not around. Let me see here. 1 Kings 5, 13. Let me see here. Now, Judges, also, you got to remember, too, Judges is out of order.
Oh, yeah.
Depending on what chapter that was from, that might be very three. Early in the book of Judges, that chapter that's the three, case.
Yeah.
So, chapter 3, hold on. No, that would be late. Okay, never mind. Chapter 3 is like the end. That's like the, that would be way after Yahusha's time period. Let me see. 1 Kings 5:13, though, says, raise a levy out of all Yashra, and levy was 30,000 men. Okay, yeah, that's not what I'm looking for. Not what I'm looking for. Not what I'm looking for. I'm looking for the building of the temple. I wonder if it's in chapter 6 or 7, where it talks about the slave labor. Because that would give all the tribes that are still there at that time.
You also have the Amorites in Judges 6, Judges 10, Judges 11. I'm sorry. Well, Judges 11 doesn't count because it's tracing history.
Yeah, let me see here. I just want to figure out whether this is... Here we go. 1 Kings 9. That's what I was thinking about. All right. It says here... Here we go. I think it's towards the end of the chapter, probably. Here we go, verse 20. 1 Kings 9:20. So that none of the people should rule over him that was left of the Hittite. Yep. Well, here's more proof. Amorite, Perizzite, Canaanite, Hivite, Jebusite, Girgashite, who are not of the children of Yisrael. So it seems like they didn't utterly wipe out any of the tribes. Is there anyone that's actually missing from that list? Hittite.
Yeah, there's a couple.
Hittite might be missing. Oh, no, Hittite's there. Amorite, Perizzite, Hivite, Canaanite, Jebusite, Girgashite. What's the one that would be missing?
Oh, wow. I'm looking at the Masoretic. Apparently, the Masoretic actually has a lot less in that list.
Yeah.
1, 2, 5,
Amorites listed.
Yeah, all seven are listed in the Septuagint. So the Septuagint would allude to that none of them were fully wiped out. Which would make sense why Yahuwah is extremely pissed in the book of Judges. This would actually make a lot of sense why he's like, what are you doing? Like, you're making covenants with these people. What are you doing? All that. So it makes sense why Judges 2, you have Yahusha,
yeah,
like, laying down the law to them, like, why have you done this? So all seven are there in the Septuagint. The Masoretic, I guess, is missing one or two.
See, so yeah, that's what I understand then, because there's a lot of places in Joshua that it makes it seem like these nations were completely wiped out. Not all of them, but some of them.
Yeah. I've noticed that they like to leave out the Girgashite in the Masoretic many times, not just here, but many times.
I'm wondering if the book of has been corrupted in its details.
Yeah. It wouldn't make sense that the Amorites were utterly wiped out if they're still there in both versions. Doesn't make sense. So the Girgashites, I wonder if they believe that the Girgashites were wiped out. That's why they're taking them out. I wonder if they have like their own traditions or Mishnah that the Girgashites were wiped out, so that's why they removed the name Girgashites there, and why they keep removing Girgashites like in multiple passages, because it's very weird that the Masoretes are always leaving that tribe out. Yeah.
I wonder if the Masoretes were part Girgashite.
Maybe. Or they wanted to make their ancestors look more righteous than they were,
mm-hmm,
by making it look like they utterly wiped out at least one of the tribes. There, yeah. But if the Amorites did survive around Solomon's time, then they definitely never wiped them out completely. If that's supposed to be there, if Amorite is supposed to be there in 1 Kings 9, then yeah, I would have to side with the option that they were just wiped out as like being a nation. They were no longer a nation. They might have had some individuals still left, which doesn't make sense though, because there's somewhere in Deuteronomy where it talks about Og was like the last of, or maybe no, what I'm thinking of, it says, I'm misremembering, it would say that Og was the last of the Rephaim, not Amorites. Supposedly the Rephaim are like the progeny of somehow go back to the older tribes of giants, if I'm not mistaken. They would go back to the original post-flood giants. So actually, yeah, so that, I don't know. That's just another thing that's very weird, that is very deliberate. They've changed. So let me see here. Okay, so see if there's not anything else, we'll jump right to 22. Pierce of Sorrow. So, was there any importance about this Nabuthai guy, the Jezreelite? It's just interesting because we see that the Hosea prophecy, right, talks about great will be the day of Jezreel. And then you have a Jezreelite mentioned in this chapter with the context of this is all talking about the northern house and King Ahab being king of the northern house. Very interesting.
It's interesting. I just looked at this right now. But it's interesting. Naboth means fruits. It would actually be Naboot. So Nab would be fruit, and then Ut, so fruits. And then you have he's a Jezreelite, which seems to mean stone of Allah, or son of Alua. So you have son of Alua that had a vineyard, and then you have killing this person. I don't know what to make of that, but that's kind of interesting.
Oh, the owner, the
Yeah.
parable of the master of the vineyard.
Oh.
Yahusha is the one killed. Because I remember I was reading this, I think, a couple of weeks ago in one of the Besorah accounts. I think it might have been Luke, where he was talking about, he was referring to the Pharisees as the men that killed the master of the vineyard. He said, you know, they said to themselves secretly, let's kill the son of the master of the vineyard so that the vineyard would be ours.
Wow.
And the Pharisees got pissed because they knew he was referring to them in a third person way. He was referring to them as those murderers. And so yeah, that's probably why this guy was given this name and why he was called the Jezreelite. Probably why he was a Jezreelite given that name, because you know Yahuwah sows Ephraim back in the book of Hosea. Actually, I want to read that real quick where it talks about great is the day of Jezreel. Let's see here. Because a lot of people get this wrong, especially in the church, they get this misunderstood. They think this is talking about like Christianity, and they get this wrong. Some of Israel became like the Gentiles. So when Yahuwah, sometimes when Yahuwah says those that were not my people, that's not necessarily referring to only wild branches. So when you understand the Samaritans and the Northern House, it actually makes sense what he's talking about here. So it says here in Hosea 1:4, Yahuwah said to him, call his name Jezreel. For yet a little while I will avenge the blood of Jezreel on the house of Yehuda. So I guess Hosea would be after First Kings. I will make to cease the kingdom of the house of Israel, so the northern house. And it shall be in that day I will break the bow of Yasharal in the valley of Jezreel. She shall conceive, she conceive again and bore a daughter. He said, call her name Unpitied, for I will no more have mercy on the house of Israel, but surely set myself in array against them. So notice how there's no mention of Gentiles here. This is all about Ephraim. This is all about the northern house. But I will have mercy on the house of Yehuda and save them by Yahuwah their Elohim, which the Masoretic text, I think, leaves out Yahuwah there, if I'm not mistaken. It will just say they'll be saved by their Elohim. I will not save them with bow nor sword, nor by war, nor by horses, nor by horsemen. Now, this is a foreshadowing to Yahusha, because the way we are saved is by him sacrificing himself, not by war. And she weaned unpitied, and she conceived again and bore a son, and called his name Not My People. For you are not my people, and I am not your Elohim. Yet the number of the children of Yisrael was as the sand of the sea, which shall not be numbered, measured nor numbered, and shall come to pass in the place where it was said to them, you are not my people. Even they shall be called sons of the living Elohim. And the children of Yehuda shall be gathered, and the children of Yisrael together, and shall appoint themselves one head, and shall come out of the land. For great shall be the day of Jezreel. So the day of Jezreel is actually about when the two houses come back together physically in the land, which has not happened. Basically, the second Exodus is the day of Jezreel. Mm-hmm. And so this is kind of tied to what Brother Yehusha brought up and what you, Mom, you read. So notice, though, how the whole time the people that he's saying are not his people, he's not talking about mm-hmm. Gentiles. He's talking about the house of Israel. Mm-hmm. So a lot of times we try to take that and appropriate it to the church, which is kind of ridiculous, because he's talking about Ephraim the whole time. He's talking about the northern house the whole time. Mm-hmm. So that's where the grafting in concept is important to understand, because this is part of prophecy that he would take Ephraim back. He would take the prodigal son back, because the prodigal son is not about you. It's not about me. It's about the northern house as a whole, is the prodigal son. And that's what that story really is about. It's about Judah, who supposedly is prideful and saying, you know, I'm better than him, Dad. I've been more obedient to you. And, you know, look, you know, why do you never did anything for me? And, you know, and, you know, you have this sibling rivalry, basically, of Judah thinking they're better than the northern house. And and Yahuwah is trying to say to him, listen, like, your brother was dead, and now he's alive again. Mm-hmm. That the brother being mentioned is the northern house, 10 northern tribes. So that's the whole purpose of the prodigal son story. But anyway, so a lot of that gets misunderstood, because we're told to throw away Israel. We're told that we, as Gentiles being grafted in, somehow replace Israel. And that's what happens. So it's important to understand what Hosea 1 in context is actually talking about, who it's talking about. That's why I do believe that for the majority, and I don't know how this works perfectly, because there is scripture from Ezekiel that says we'll choose our own tribe and all that in the kingdom. So I'm not going to get into all that, but I do think a lot of us that seem to not have any Israelite lineage automatically go into one of the 10 northern tribes. That Ephraim is supposed to be the fullness of the Goyim. So the fullness of the nations come into the northern house. So I could be wrong, though. Like, I'm not saying I know I'm 100% correct on that, but from what I've seen, if it seems like from your own ethnicity, if you've done any DNA testing and it seems like you don't have any Israelite lineage, by default, you would go into one of those tribes. You know, so, and the reference I'm talking about, the fullness of the nations, is Genesis 48:19, where it talks about his seed would become a multitude of nations, meaning from Ephraim, the person, would come multiple ethnicities.
Right.
So anyway. So yeah. But anyway, I just wanted to mention that. Trying to think, is there anything? I think that's pretty much it for 21. Let's see. All right. So we are at 1 Kings 22. I think this will be the last chapter for today. Woo! Okay. This is a lengthy one. I think I might have to split this with someone. All right. Yeah, I think I might do like the first 25, 26 verses, and then we'll have someone pick up after that. Okay. 1 Kings 22. And he rested 3 years, and there was no war in Syria and Yashar'el. And it came to pass in the third year that Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, went down to the king of Yashar'el. The king of Yashar'el said to his servants, "Know ye that Ramah Gilead, ours, we are slow to take it out of the hand of the king of Syria." And the king of Yashar'el said to Jehoshaphat, "Will you go up with us to Ramah Gilead to battle?" Now, just a little tidbit here. Syria, for those that are interested, it seems like Syria today would be Aramea in ancient times. So the Arameans were the Syrians, where we get the Aramaic language, Syriac language. It's pretty much one and the same. So there's little, I mean, you could say there's nuances in their language differences, but it's pretty much the same people. So from my understanding, Jehoshaphat said, "As I am, so you also as my people, so your people as my horses, so your horses, Jehoshaphat, king of Yehuda." All right, so Jehoshaphat, king of Yehuda, said to the king of Yashar'el, "Inquire, I pray you, of Yahuwah today." And king of Yashar'el gathered all the prophets together, about 400 men, and the king said to them, "By the way, mom, does yours say 400?
See. 400 men, yes.
Okay. And the king said to them, "Shall I go up to Ramoth Gilead to battle, or shall I forbear?" And they said, "Go up, and Yahuwah will surely give into the hands of the king." And Jehoshaphat said to the king of Yashar'el, "Is there not here a prophet of Yahuwah that we may inquire of Yahuwah?" By him, as the king of Yashar'el said to Jehoshaphat, "There is one man here to inquire of Yahuwah, but I hate him, for he does not speak tube of me, but only evil." Micaiah, son of Yambala, Jehoshaphat, king of Yehuda, said, "Let not the king say so." King of Yashar'el called a eunuch and said, "Bring quickly Micaiah, son of Yambla." Okay. Hold on a second, guys. Just doing something real quick. King of Yashar'el and king of and Jehoshaphat, king of Yehuda, sat each on his throne, armed in the gates of Samaria. Again, guys, Samaria was the headquarters of the northern house. And all the prophets prophesied before them. And Zedekiah, son of Kenan, made for himself iron horns and said, "Thus says Yahuwah, with these you shall push Syria until it be consumed." And all the prophets prophesied in like manner, saying, "Go up to Ramah Gilead and shall prosper, and Yahuwah shall deliver it to the king of Syria into your hands." And the messenger that went to call Micaiah spoke to him, saying, "Behold, now all the prophets speak with one mouth. Two concerning the king, let now the words be like the words of one of them, speak two things." And Micaiah said, "As Yahuwah lives, whatsoever Yahuwah shall say to me, that I will speak." And he came to the king, and the king said to him, "Micaiah, shall I go up to Ramah Gilead to battle, or shall I forbear?" And he said, "Go up, and Yahuwah shall deliver it into the hand of the king." And the king said to him, "How often shall I adjure you, and you speak to me in the truth? And that you speak to me in truth in the name of Yahuwah." He said, "Not so. I saw all Yashar'el scattered on the mountains of the flock, found a shepherd." And Yahuwah said, "Not is Yahuwah." All right. Okay. This, it's very weird the way the Bretons is worded here. Hold on a second. Okay. And Yahuwah said, "Is not Eluah master of these? Or is not Elohim master of these? Let each one return to his home in peace." The king of Yisrael said to Jehoshaphat, king of Yehuda, did I not say to you that this man does not prophesy to me, for he speaks nothing but evil? So far we have this one king of Israel that's like, basically he's just like, he wants a false prophet to speak what he wants to hear.
That's right.
Like he has tickling ears, basically. Micaiah said, not so. Is it not, I hear the word of Yahuwah, and is it not so? I saw the Elohim of Yashar sitting on his throne, and all the armies of heaven stood around him, on his right hand and on his left. So if you, this is like a perfect understanding of what's called the heavenly court, or the celestial council here. You have Yahuwah on his throne and his messengers on the right and on the left, all on thrones with him. So you would have the, it's known in modern day terms, they call it the divine council, but that's what you see up there in the highest heaven. That's why in the book of Enoch, it even talks about wisdom sat among the messengers. So you would have the messengers serving Yahuwah, serving Yahusha, and they're sitting on thrones while Yahuwah and Yahusha is on the, you know, grandest throne above them. Or you could say in the middle, you would have Yahuwah on his throne, and they're sitting around him. So, yeah. And Yahuwah said, who will deceive Ahab, king of Yashar, that he may go up and fall in Ramoth Gilead? And one spoke one way and another way. And there came forth a spirit and stood before Yahuwah and said, I will deceive him. So this is a perfect example here of demons don't serve Satan. Okay? Demons have to go to Yahuwah, just like Satan has to go to Yahuwah and has to say, can I do this? Can I do that? Even the demons, even fallen Malikim as well, have to ask Yahuwah for permission, because Yahuwah is supreme over all. And so just wanted to put that out there, because I know that's a big false doctrine out there that Satan's the king of demons or whatever. So, and Yahuwah said to him, whereby? And he said, I will go forth and will be a false spirit in the mouth of all his prophets. And he said, you shall deceive him, yea, and shall prevail. Go forth and do so. And I know you might be thinking, this is weird that Yahuwah is allowing him to deceive someone. But you got to understand, Yahuwah is basically allowing a deceiving spirit to deceive the wicked.
Mm-hmm.
Is really what's going on.
That's right.
Basically, this spirit is going to the wicked king of Israel. So that's the context there. And behold, now Yahuwah has put a false spirit in the mouth of all these prophets, and Yahuwah has spoken evil against you. And Zedekiah, the son of Canaan, came near and smote Micaiah on the cheek and said, what sort of a spirit of Yahuwah has spoken in you? And Micaiah said, behold, you shall see in that day that you shall go into an innermost chamber to hide yourself there. Okay. I'll read this verse and then we'll try to have someone else finish up here. So, or actually, I'll end at like verse 27. Verse 26, and the king of Yashar said, take Micaiah and convey him away to Samer, the keeper of the city, and tell Joash, the king's son, to put this fellow in prison and feed him with bread of affliction and water of affliction until I return in peace. Now, I wonder if bread of affliction would be like very like humble type of bread, probably not seasoned, probably like, you know, if you think about it, like unleavened bread, like it's called bread of affliction. So, you know. Because it also says water of affliction, too. So I'm trying to think of what that would be. Wow. That would be, like, very, like, humble type of food and drink.
Mm-hmm. Possibly very limited. Like, you only get a little bit.
Yeah. Like, I would think it's not going to be seasoned that well. It's not going to be, It's like, you know, like prison break.
I mean with the water.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So, any takers for verse 28 to the rest of the chapter?
Yeah, I'll read it. I think Marissa dropped out.
Oh, okay. I didn't realize that. So I can't see it from my shared screen here.
It is possible her phone died. I don't know.
Yeah, I think so. I think so because I didn't get a text or anything.
So 28. And Micaiah said, if you ever return in Shalom, Yahuwah has not spoken by me. So the kings of Yahshua all went up, and Yehoshaphat, king of Yehuda, with him to Ramoth Gilead. And the king of Yahshua all said, Yehoshaphat, king of Yehuda, I will disguise myself and enter into the battle, and you put on my robes. So the king of Yahshua all disguised himself and went into the battle. And I don't understand why Yehoshaphat is just so naive. Like, why would you allow that? And the king of Syria had charged the 32 captains of his chariot, saying, fight not small or great, but against the king of Yahshua only. And it came to pass, when the captains of the chariot saw Yehoshaphat, king of Yehuda, that they said, this seems to be the king of Yahshua. And they compassed him about to fight against them, and Yehoshaphat cried out. And it came to pass, when the captains of the chariot saw that this was not the king of Yahshua, that they returned from him. And one drew a bow with a tube aim and struck the king of Yahshua between the lungs and the breastplate. And he said to his charioteer, turn your hands and carry me away out of the battle, for I am wounded. And the war was turned in that day, and the king was standing on the chariot against Syria from morning till evening. And he shed the blood out of his wound into the bottom of the chariot and died at evening. The blood ran out of the wound into the bottom of the chariot. The herald of the army stood at sunset, saying, let every man go to his own city and his own land, for the king is dead. And they came to Samaria and buried the king in Samaria. And they washed the chariot at the fountain of Samaria, and the swine and the dogs licked up the blood. And the harlots washed themselves in the blood, according to the word of Yahuwah which he spoke. That's gross. And the rest of the acts of Ahab and all that he did in the ivory house which he built and all the cities which he built, behold, are not these things written in the books in the book of the Chronicles of the kings of Yahshua? And Ahab slept with his fathers, and Ahaziah his son reigned in his place. And Yehoshaphat the son of Asa reigned over Yehuda. In the fourth year of Ahab, king of Yahshua, Yehoshaphat began to reign. He was 35 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 25 years in Yerushalayim, and his mother's name was Azubah, daughter of Shilhi. And he walked in all the way of Asa his father. He turned not from it, even from doing that which was right in the eyes of Yahuwah. Only he took not away the high places. People still offered and burnt offerings or burnt incense on the high places. And Yehoshaphat was at Shalom with the king of Yahshua. And the rest of the acts of Yehoshaphat and his mighty deeds, whatever he did, hold, are not these things written in the book of the Chronicles, the kings of Yehuda? And Yehoshaphat slept with his fathers and was buried by his fathers in the city of Dude, his father, and Yehoram, his son, reigned in his place. And Ahaziah, son of Ahab, reigned over Yahshua in Samaria. In the 17th year of Yehoshaphat, king of Yehuda, Ahaziah, son of Ahab, reigned over Yahshua in Samaria 2 years. And he did that which was evil in the sight of Yahuwah, and walked in the way of Ahab his father, and in the way of Isabel his mother, and in the sons, and in the sins of the house of Yeroboam, the son of Nebat, who caused Yahshua to sin. And he served the Baalim and worshipped them and provoked Yahuwah Eloah of Yeshua according to all that had been done before him.
Mom, you got any thoughts on that or no?
Not really. It's pretty much straightforward, I think, you know, factual.
Yeah.
Now, Jezebel's still alive, right? Ahab died first. Was that? Did I miss something?
Yeah, no, she's still alive.
She's still alive.
I think she survives for a couple more chapters.
Right, right.
It's interesting because it's even though she doesn't, you know, even though she doesn't marry her son like Semiramis, you still have her in a way ruling, even though her son Ahaziah is king.
Yeah, she definitely operates in that spirit. Definitely,
yeah.
Oh. Okay, well, I think that's about it for today. Okay, so I think Yahuwah willing for all of our viewers and listeners out there, Yahuwah willing will be starting 2 Kings next week. Please stay tuned. We'll also be Yahuwah willing, Yahusha willing. We're going to really start working on a couple of, you know, studies that I really want to start doing. We pretty much started, for those that have missed it, we did a part one to the differences in the book of Psalms. We'll definitely be doing, you know, a couple different more parts to finish that study. I'm also compiling Yahuwah willing, Yahusha willing right now. I've been doing a Google Doc on Esther, so hopefully soon I'll be done with the differences in the book of Esther on the document. So, yeah, we definitely have a couple of studies in the future. One that's a really big project that me and Brother Yahusha are definitely both feel led to do is a whole big expose on certain religions that are influences to the people in the body of Messiah right now in a negative way. Kabbalism, Gnosticism, those are two big heretical man-made religions that have shaped a lot of the heresy that's in the body of Messiah comes from those two main religions. I would say right now the body has a lot more leaven from, I would say, Gnosticism than the Kabbalah, but there's still certain things out there that are from Kabbalah as well that have crept in. So I think Yahuwah, it is his and Yahusha's will to really get us to start doing those particular studies, to really give at least give a defense for people like us that know about these things and can show people, you know, what Yahuwah has shown us through research, where a lot of these belief systems come from. So I hope you guys enjoyed the study today. I hope all the viewers and listeners that are going to see this will enjoy this. I know we had to do this cloud recording, and then I have to upload it to YouTube, but hopefully you guys on YouTube will enjoy it, get some edification out of it. And I just want to say Shabbat Shalom to our brothers and sisters. This is Brother Doug, Sister Sharon, and Brother Yahusha signing off from the Awakened by Yahuwah Assembly. Have a great rest of your Shabbat, guys, in Yahuwah Almighty, Yahusha Messiah. Shalom.